Welcome back, everybody, as I am joined here by, well, someone, guys, some face. I'm sorry. There he goes, just introduces himself because I couldn't do it. Chaos, of course, a very known face here in the scene and currently the coach for Team Coast. Now, Chaos, give me your take on that game because obviously your team took a while to wake up in it.
Yeah, just a bit of history. LoL Pro is actually known for very long extended games where they close it out after a team fight when they scaled up with Kog'Maw and like Jax. And for us, we're actually known to control blues, really snowball the early game, and close out the game in 20 minutes. So they kind of beat us at our own game, then we beat them at theirs, and it worked out.
So what did you tell the team here? Because obviously they did struggle in an early game, and if it happens again, maybe LoL Pro can just close it out next time.
Well, I've been telling them to have timers and communicate the entire, I don't even know, for the past month, and they really didn't do that. So I don't know what the hell's going on, but I don't know. I have absolute confidence in my team, and this game too will be much cleaner, I'm sure.
It looks like you have a hard hand in that team as well. So tell us, is this what you're going to be doing for the next while? Is this the coach job, or do you still want to go back to playing? I mean, if you see a venue like this, I bet you want to be up there as well.
I actually really wanted to be a coach even when I played for TSM. And oh, boy. Yeah. And now I have the opportunity to be one. I think North America, even Europe, really needs infrastructure, and coaching is a part of that. And I'm happy to take the first step in that direction.
Well, we're happy to see you in the scene, of course. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
And we're going to see how Coast is going to do in that second game versus LoL Pro. So let's go back to the guys at the desk, Joe and Fisho.
Thank you very much, Shox. And welcome back, ladies and gentlemen, to the North American Challenger Series Finals live from Wembley Arena here in London, England. It's 1-0 to Coast. And apparently they weren't doing what Chaox has told them. So maybe if they listen to him after that first game, then things are going to get better for them.
It was pretty clear, at least when it comes down to timers of dragons, blue buffs, they were slacking a little bit. I mean, he just said it himself. They clearly didn't time things properly. We saw it. The very first dragon fight, actually, was Coast coming in very, very late from multiple sides and just ended up dying two or three members, giving over the dragon as well, and started the whole snowballing for LoL Pro. So definitely need to step it up. I like the way he gives the history here with LoL Pro being the team normally, picking the late game comp, going these 60 minutes in, and then winning the game. And they did it this time around, where LoL Pro had more of a mid-game comp. Yeah. We need to see if they want to pick late game now and try and maybe extend the game towards the late game. And then we can see if Coast can clear out or win the game early on.
So that was basically my next question to you anyway. Are we going to see a change in composition here and the way that these teams are focusing on game number two after that first one?
I mean, I would think so, looking at what the teams normally do, what their normal play style is. But if you look at Coast comp here, they don't have to change too many things because they actually had a very good early comp as well with the Ziggs. Mm. We talked about their Corki very strong in lane as well. So they had a comp where they could actually have won early game in the lanes and then just snowball the game. They didn't have to go late game with the Jax. I mean, they had good enough comp to win in the mid game as well. So they don't necessarily need to change anything. I wouldn't say LoL Pro have to do it either. They just need to be able to close out the game and not take the wrong team fights.
And that was the problem, that they weren't really dictating any of those team fights. They'd push up to the turret. We saw it in the bottom lane. We saw it in the top lane two or three times as well, that they'd get to the tower, as you would expect them to do, and Italy starts throwing in the spears, and then Rooks would just say, okay, we're going to fight now. Yep. Hook comes in, Rooks dives in on top of them as well. We'll see if anything changes, though, here as we move into Champion Select for game number two between Coast and LoL Pro. LoL Pro, of course, switching over now onto the blue team. And we see the bans coming out here. Twisted Fate, the first ban from LoL Pro. On the other side, Kale. So up until now, not much changing.
Nothing at all so far. We even see Nidalee just been instant locked here from LoL Pro. They had it the last game. It worked out pretty well for them up until the very late game team fights, where, of course, Coast were the stronger team. And Kuroi often actually catch out Lord on this Nidalee here and kill him very easily, which was a big issue. And of course, his position needs to change.
So let's have a look then. We saw in game number one that AD carries were focused somewhat from Champion Select. We're going to see Lucian getting through this one. Elise picked up for Santorin and actually didn't die somehow. I'm not sure how he managed to not die throughout that entire last game.
Well, to be fair, he didn't have too much impact in the game itself. Even the team fights, it wasn't built around him doing too much. Even his cocoons, it was more the hooks from Sheep actually starting the fights. And it was all about Rox jumping in, Mash doing the damage with Golden Blue from the backside here. So he never actually had to go very deep in. He never had to try and sacrifice himself. And therefore, he didn't have to die. And overall, you can turn around and say it was also great positioning, great performance. Personally, I want to see more early game pressure from him, especially compared to how much Heaven Time actually did on this list in early on.
Yeah, and we're also going to see Jax again in this game, but swapped around, going to be with LoLPro this time. Haunter can't take anything away from him. Had a fantastic game on that Shyvana, was on a rampage at one point. Will be playing the Jax this time around. On the other side, though, Renekton picked up here for Rux.
Yeah, so we do actually see teams switching up a little bit now. Jax, the late game monster for LoLPro this time around. They want to go late game now, and we have Renekton, early game powerhouse from Team Coast. So now they're actually looking to close out the game within the 30, 35 minute mark. Maybe we can put it up to 40. But from there on, once Jax really starts hitting his items, he's just going to destroy Renekton in these one-on-ones here and will force Team Coast then to find other ways of trying to close out the game, because they won't be able to do it by killing Jax one-on-one.
And while we're on the topic of late game, yeah. Pogmore, possible AD carry choice here for LoLPro. That may, of course, change here. Just switching around there. Obviously, Lucian Walls picked up on the other side for Mash, who played Corki in that last matchup. So we are going to see Kog'Maw and Morgana. So late game again there coming out from the AD carry. And that's what we heard earlier on, that late game is something that LoLPro have done time and time again. On the other side though, Coast with their final choice here for the mid lane, going to take LeBlanc for Golden Blue.
So with the Syndra ban, which is one of the soft counters to LeBlanc in lane, you can lock it in safely. Of course, you already saw the mid lane pick was the first pick in Italy, but didn't want to risk anything from LoLPro picking Syndra early on so they couldn't go LeBlanc against it. But now, looking at Coast, I mean, they're just looking to be so, so strong in the early mid game here. While late game, of course, is going to be all about LoLPro. I mean, Bootstomp and Haunts are going to scale so well into late game point. You have Nidalee with the Spears, Morgana to disengage, to peel. So we're basically just turning things around here. Coast now looking to close out the game. We need to see if they can do it. They definitely need to have more control of the Dragon. They need to have more control of the blue buffs if they want to get this early lead, unless they just want to straight up try and win in the laning phase. But it will require some aggressive play from Centaurin and some good ganks.
Well, we did see how Coast won in game number one, but do you guys think that LoLPro will be able to come back here and force a game number three? Tell us who you think will win this match by tweeting hashtag CSTWin or hashtag ProWin to at LOL Esports. We'll take a look at your results soon, of course. The previous vote, lolesports.com, you guys voted actually all for LoLPro, but that switched as we came into the match, and I think it was about 75% for Coast in game number one, so you were right on that front. Question is now, can they do it here in the early game against a late game comp from LoLPro?
LoLPro definitely want to lane swap this one. They don't want to put Jax against Renekton, and you don't really want to have the fresh Lucian lane against you as well, and the bottom lane is such a strong lane. So they want to lane swap around here. They might also have to go in towards the mid lane and give some help to the Nidalee, because against LeBlanc, I mean, it's such a hard lane.
Well, we're going to find out exactly if those swaps are going to be coming in as we get into game number two between LoLPro and Coast, with Coast leading this best of three, 1-0. And two games in a row is what LoLPro need to win here to pick themselves up a victory overall in this best of three in the first Challenger Series of the Summer Split. We'll see how that one all goes for them. Of course, they had a good start in that last game, just not quite able to finish things off. This time around, though, the later things go, the more you're going to fancy them. Oh, don't face check low.
Don't face checks. Still, it's under 2 minutes, of course, so he doesn't give too much gold for the first board, but it's never a good start, and we actually see Coast doing the same thing they did the last game. They group as five and move into the enemy jungle here, put up some wards, try and spot out what's going to happen here. If they can maybe see the lane swap and then swap up to top lane themselves and punish the lane swap and get the standard lane. So maybe they just want to allow the lane swap from LoLPro and instead take the dragon early on and try and get the lead this way.
Well, Coast ahead of down bottom. There is that ward. And on the other side of the map, LoLPro up by red, but they're spotted out by that ward. So Coast actually have vision of that one. But do they want to try anything? Yeah, there's another ward going down. Pretty much mirror image on the other side of the map.
And look here. Instantly on your minimap, Sheep and Mesh are recalling because they want to go to this top lane. They saw Kog'Maw move from the ward up to the top side, so they really want to go for these 2v2 lanes. Hoodstomp actually, is he going to recall and go down this bottom lane? That might be tricking them. Spamming recall for now.
Well, either way, we are going
to see. No, he's staying. Yeah, it would be too late for him to move anyway now. Of course, the top laner can always teleport down. Never mind, they actually spotted with the ward from Lulpro here. As soon as they saw Mesh run by it, or Sheep run by it, they know, okay, now they're going to be top lane. So now they are recalling to the bottom side. And this pretty much explains why you put this very deep ward in here and Hoodstomp, why he was waiting in the bush, recalling, stop recalling, just waiting to see if he could see anyone. So Lulpro, they dodge the lane swap, or sorry, they dodge the standard lanes and get the lane swap.
So, Bluewolf here taken by Heaven Time with the help of Haunter on Jax. And that's going to leave Mash and Sheep alone for now in this top lane. We already have Rooks actually down in the bottom lane here, but Hoodstomp and Low are going to be moving in there in just a few moments. So, Rooks' time going to be going a bit harder. And again, 75% vote in favor of Coast.
Still though, we simply need to see a better early mid game for Coast this game here, otherwise they won't get a lead, they won't be able to close out the game before Hansa and Hoodstomp become absolute monsters, and it can really be a big issue. And in the start here again, Lulpro, it's great for them to get the lane swap, they can get a few levels, get some farm onto Hoodstomp here, get some dodge around this Renekton as well early on, won't have all the pressure onto Jax, so it's a good start for them. Still need to see how they want to play out this lane swap. In the semi-finals, Coast were really good at playing the lane swaps, but it was actually always the other way around, where they were bot lane with their own dual lane. This time around, they're top, so now the dragon control is actually for Lulpro, and they should be able to pick up a dragon early on, unless Sheep, he decides to roam around, and there we go.
There we go, going straight in here for dragon, 3 minutes and 20 seconds into the game. That's a level 1 low, though, and it takes a lot of damage here from that dragon. You have to juggle the damage from that one quite effectively here if you're going to be able to take that dragon down and not embarrassingly, I think, lose a member, as we are going to see safeguards coming in there. Doing a decent job of juggling.
It's Haunter
who's got to have that one. He is going to be able to tank that one up. And there we go. Dragon taken down. 3 minutes 45 into the game. Nice little start for Lulpro.
Yeah, great stuff for Lulpro here. Playing the lane swap really well. It's actually something we don't see very often in Europe. When you have this lane swap here, you don't really take advantage of the dual lane being up top. Definitely something NA has picked up on and doing it pretty much every single game there is a lane swap. Rockstar putting down the ward, spotting two members waiting for him.
Ah, should probably maybe back away from them. Actually, got Santorin coming in. That's a lot of damage to Heaven Time already. And he will safeguard away. There was actually a flash used there by Rooks trying to get in to lock up that kill.
So use the flash here, of course, means in case they want to try and go for a dive, later on here, it won't be up. They can maybe try and pick up a kill, but we do actually just see Centaurin staying with Rox here, making sure he gets a lot of farm in his lane here. They're not running together and jumping like we see the Jax and the Lee Sin doing. They're just making sure that Rox can actually farm in the lane because he's Renekton and he is so strong early on.
Centaurin staying in there as well. Made those double buffs on. Mid lane, actually, we've not really seen all that much of that one. They're pretty much level on CS, slight advantage for Golden Glue, level 5 to the level 4 of Lord's Nidalee there. But that should level itself up here pretty soonish. In terms of the AD carries, Hoodstomp the one with the slight early advantage. You can see there making sure that lane, of course, as I say that, it just kills them off straight away.
So they push it out here. Maybe they're expecting actually Coast to swap around and get the dual lane down towards them. So they want to push out the lane, could recall and then go towards top lane and continue this 2v1 situation. And they now do spot Mesh and Sheep. Obviously return to lane, now Hoodstomp can go back and shop. We need to see if he wants to go to top lane or if he want to return to this bottom lane and stop playing standard lanes from now on. Could still be a very big issue for Haunter here. He's only level 2. Rox is very fired and also has a very big minion wave, so big trouble for Jax if they keep this standard lane.
Oh, Santorin actually going to be faced off here by Heaven Type. We saw the spear coming around, that's a good cocoon note to stop Heaven Type pushing in. Golden Glue actually going aggressive there onto Lord as well, but with Heaven Type hanging around, he needs to get away.
Oh, he's
going to land on the minion, not quite. Could have been dangerous there for Golden Glue.
And Lord is doing a very good job farming in this mid lane. He did the same thing last game on Nidalee. He's very good at farming early on, where all the pressure should actually be on him, because again, the only thing he can respond with is trying to throw a spear and then start auto-attacking, heal himself a few times trying to sustain, but he doesn't do any damage in return. But still, farming really well here. Now he hit the level 6 point, which really is where Nidalee can start doing something.
Well, That is a strange horn. So, that 2v2 down bottom. That completely threw me off my game. Not gonna lie. Go on, DeFicio, talk for a bit.
Well, let's see. Centaurian actually in this top lane here. Every time doing the exact same thing to Joe Miller. Might need you very soon.
May do, or possibly not. Let's have a look. Haunter, level 4 in there, and Santorin actually just backing away from this one. Actually, there's a ward there, spotting him by the backside of that red buff. And actually, we're going to see Haunter going aggressive here a little bit on Rooks, but he just sidesteps away from the counter-strike with Heaven Time around, though. That
may make
things a little bit more dangerous.
They want to push the wave out so it resets, bounted off the tower here so he can actually start picking up some farm. And oh, nice hook from Sheep.
Oh, going on towards Hudstomp. This is going to be a lot of damage coming in there. Hudstomp is going to go low. No kill for them here, though, Coast. And either way, that will force Hudstomp to back off. Didn't use any of his summoner spells, though, there.
Such a great play to Centaurian. Oh, lands the cocoon.
Lands the cocoon. Have they got the damage to follow up? Heaven Time wall still hanging around. Santorin actually pushing in a little bit more aggressive on this one. Just going to check exactly what's going on. That blue buff has respawned onto the map. Golden Glue going to come around. We've got Nidalee there already. And going to try and pull that one into the brush. Deny the vision from Santorin's side of things, but he's down to half HP. He's going to actually go over to Lod in the end, but Haunter going to be focused here. He will actually get away. Heaven Time, the next focus as he gets locked up by the chains. Can they finish him off? Rappel, not really going to bring anything there for Santorin. Comes back down. Blue buff did, in the end, go over to Lod, I do believe.
Yeah, it did.
And
it
no
did.
Kills.
And that's a very big thing for Lopra here. You want to have this blue buff on Nidalee so he can start really sustaining himself and just farm away. Haunter now, teleport top lane, down this bottom lane. Once again, some action. Another hook.
Hook going in on towards low. There is a good binding, though, onto Mash. And actually going to return a decent amount of damage here is Hudstomp. That's going to force Coast to back away from things. So, pretty tense start here from both sides. And we've seen a couple of plays going low, but still no first blood. 8.5 minutes in.
Sheep is playing very well, however. He's constantly baiting out the Black Shield and then going for the opposite target. Gets the hook there, gets some damage in. Haunter now, playing back with some damage, and then Renekton is Renekton, and he just sustains.
Oh, down on this bottom lane. Oh, he's going to get finded in there. They're going to go for this one. First blood coming down for low. He's going to fall here, though, and that's a kill back for Mash. Meanwhile, Rooks diving in on that top lane. Level 7 will take down Haunter without any problems. Leaves Coast, after all that said and done, 2-1 up in kills.
Haunter is so far behind after the lane swap, where he was forced to jungle with Heaven Time and also did the dragon, so didn't get any farm at this point here, while Rooks was farming the bottom lane with help from Centaurian. And once he got up to this top lane and the wave was pushing towards Rooks, he could just keep picking up farm and denying so much from Haunter. I mean, he's two levels behind and he just got dove 1v1.
Not good news. That pickaxe start for Rooks.
He's going to go straight into the TM and just try and bully him out.
Just try and destroy him in that lane. We see Golden Glue also getting himself the blue buff there in that mid lane. We've actually got Dragon coming up in just a couple of seconds' time as well. That turret actually is going to go down here to the minion, so Haunter losing himself out on the kill. He has to freeze it here. Yeah. He's so far behind that he can't afford to push that straight out.
So normally you would think, why does he let his own tower die? But it's simply because he wants the minion wave to stay. He doesn't want it to die to the tower, so he can now freeze it and hopefully pick up some farm before Rox returns to lane. I hope that Rox is going somewhere else on the map to make a play while he just farms up, because again, he is so far behind. Mashed looks pretty good.
Actually,
calling and then start recalling.
Recalling.
Pretty badass.
Bullying. They're going to get this dragon. Nothing that Pro can do about this one. And that gives them now a 1500 goal lead. Healthy start. And we see that Haunter's like, ah. Renekton's back. I'm not going to fight him with that one. Got himself double Doran's blade, pickaxe, and a longsword in there with boots as well. So doing a lot of damage. He's 3 levels above him. 3 levels there. That's not good news for Haunter.
Luckily for him, Centaurian was busy doing the dragon, so he couldn't be around his top lane here. When Renekton is so far ahead, what you can do is send your jungler up to the side where your Renekton is, and then as soon as the big wave hits the tower, you just dive onto the Jax, kill him or force him away and deny him everything. It's also why Heaven Time is staying around. It's not to try and kill Rooks, it's simply to make sure that Haunter can actually pick up this farm here, and he won't get killed again by Rooks and lose even more CS and more XP.
So here we go then, Golden Glue gonna go in on towards Lod. Actually a lot of damage, chains not proccing though, so not going to get locked up in that mid lane and risk a little bit more damage. Ultimate from Golden Blue was actually used as Mash going to go offensive there on towards Hudstomp. Is Cheap going to be able to get in? Goes for the flake. Good Black Shield though from Low.
A lot of action here. Sheep keeps looking for the hook every single time he has the chance. It did backfire a little bit before when he actually died, gave up the first spot. Luckily for Coast, it actually went to Low on Morgana, where Mash would then reply. Actually, no, Sheep also picked up a kill for him. So both supports getting kills in his bottom lane.
Good trade there for Haunter, actually, in his top lane. Although, pulling back at the right
so
time.
There's still the ulti coming in.
Yeah, and of course, he's just going to bring all that back there. We just see him gaining a load more health. Heaven Time waiting off to the side. Santorin is actually still here, so they may bait them out, although there is that ward there as well on the white spawn, so that's going to mean that Lolpro not going to be forced into a fight. There was a ward there as well off to the side, so both teams realizing that they're spotted.
But we did see the thing for Santorin to move to the lane with the Renekton and stay around and see if they can get up another kill for Haunter, deny him even more. Oh. Heaven Time still staying around. Sheep going aggressive again. It's Teleport.
Teleport coming down. Low going to be the target from this one. He gets his ultimate running. The flashing over the side. Hoodstone going to be hit by the Cullen. He's going down. Ruxa's going to get himself another kill from this one. We did actually see Low getting the kill in the end onto Sheep. Meanwhile, Santorin going low here. Heaven Time going to be chasing him through. Got to land a Q here over the wall.
Oh,
and it's wide. Santorin will get away.
So actually getting a kill for each on this bottom lane here. Rox teleported down, but Sheep still ended up dying. He went very aggressive, and Mash also had to flash away actually and finish up Hoodstone with his calling. Still, again, two assists for Mash. They're not getting the kills on Teddy Carry. Instead, Rox picked up this one.
Well, it's going to mean that Renekton so much stronger than Jax. Almost double the CS, and we're talking about 100 to 50 CS here. Say a lot of extra gold, almost double the amount of gold, really. For Rux, currently sat on 1700 as well, so he's going to go back. We also saw DFG, that Deathfire Grass, picked up four Golden Glues LeBlanc. That's going to give him more burst potential, and we'll see with that item added in there if he's going to go aggressive onto Nidalee.
So really building towards snowballing with Rux here and just try and pick a target. Rux stuns it and just blow them over the landing cocoon at the hook here, and just first target they see in a fight where they land some CC, instantly destroy this target here, and therefore win the fight and take objectives or just keep pushing or pushing forward. Because again, we keep talking about how the late game point from Lolpro is very scary, but Coast, they really want to finish it early on, and so far, they're building towards it, and they're doing a good job.
Tower going down, actually the second one of the game here for Coast. Leaves them 1600 gold in the lead, and now look at this, Rux waiting off to the side. Actually, Haunter got the levels back on him, but Santorin also coming around from this one. They're going to have to try and lock him up. Counter-Strike going down. Meanwhile, Heaven Time's going to be burst down! Golden Glue, easy kill for him there. DFG straight in, and he didn't even need the CS, the CC that you were talking about earlier.
No, could just do it by himself here. Heaven Time, of course, only has Elder Lizard, so no tankiness on him. Jax on his top lane, he was forced to flash away. Once again, Coast, they keep putting pressure on this Renekton lane. They want to make sure Rox can keep snowballing it, do some damage onto the tower now. Nidalee is around though, taking quite some spears.
Yeah, got spears coming out. That might actually protect the turret from them as the Hawk comes out, but not quite landed for Sheep. But this turret, either way, is very, very low. There's a double auto attack, and that tower is going to go down here. Mash will be able to finish this one off with these next couple of shots. And actually, that leaves Low all alone. There's a binding flashing wide. Here comes Golden Glue from the side. Low going to go down. Golden Glue gets another one. However, Lonnie's going to be there. Good landing away. Great hook onto Haunter with the play as well. That is Golden Glue's Mimic. They might actually give Sheep up here. That will actually end them in a one for one. It's Lod as well that gets the kill. So both the mid laners getting killed.
Oh my god, great spear.
He wasn't expecting that.
No, he was standing there recalling and just get the spear right in his back. This should be the tower as well for Lolpro. They're definitely responding.
Tower goes down. First one of the game for Lolpro. Look at this. Rux waiting off to the side. They've got Santorin and Mash there as well. Lolpro, though, not going to be pushing through. So Curse, or Coast, because Curse aren't even playing. Coast are 5-4 up in kills, still holding that gold lead as well. And 3-1 tower count going their way. But don't forget, we have the Kog'Maw, we have the Jax that are going to be getting stronger and stronger as things go on.
And two early kills on the Nidalee can definitely slow you down as well. Once he picks up the death cap now, he's already building towards it. The spears are just going to hurt so much. Again, we're still fairly early in the game. He's already going towards the death cap now. Good reply from Lolpro. Coast needs to keep the pressure up though. They've been playing well. Applying pressure to the right lanes here, picked up some kills in the bottom lane. Of course, Rox in his top lane here was a big deal, him shutting down the Jax. After a very good lane swap for Rox and a very bad lane swap for Hornflow. And now Dragon here. Lopro is pretty out of position here. Shouldn't be able to do anything. Unless maybe Heaven Time can steal it. Oh. That's why they pull it out.
Time.
He needs to now dash over the wall.
On his side. Hits the Q there onto on the
sheep. Yeah.
Are they going to try and challenge this one? Binding comes flying through there as well. But this dragon's gone. That's going to go over to Coast. And actually in the top lane, we have a fight between Rux and Haunter once again. Rux going to get his ultimate running, but we see the Haunter winning out on this one for now. And actually dives in there. Rux going low, but not quite. One more auto attack there could have done it.
Rux had the flash as well. He didn't actually use it. He was like, yeah, no, I'm going to survive. I'm going to jump on him. Ah, that's a kill.
Oh! You mean that flash?
Yes,
flash. That's a flash. There we go. Stunt coming down onto Lord. Gets the line deal back. But it's Pierre. Torrid by Brain. Lord now behind enemy lines, but he's got the damage back.
LeBlanc coming.
Onto Santorin. LeBlanc's going to come up from this one. This is a kill for Golden Glue. Oh. And the shutdown as well.
A lot of action here, but the big thing was Jax actually fighting against Rox and winning out here. Hunter did a very, very good job. Almost killed him under the tower. Bottom lane though, they're gonna lose the spot though. They can take mid tower instead.
They're gonna take the middle outer turret, but they lose the bottom inner turret as well for that one. That keeps Coast 4-2 up in towers. And Golden Glue gonna be an important factor in these next few minutes. 3-1-0 with that LeBlanc coming up there and just mopping up that kill onto Lauren. Looks, Rux doing a god job. We have to give him that for actually surviving as long as he did. That flash that you were talking about before wasn't used and kept him alive for a little bit longer. Either way, Coast still leading this game. 3,000 gold almost a lead. And now, where are they going? They're going to try and catch out Haunter here, who's actually recalling in the middle of the lane. It's going to be up to Sheep to land the CS, and he tries to jump away, and there we see the chains coming in. Haunter's going to go down from this one. It's Mash that actually picks up the kill. There is the hook as well, on towards Heaven Time. Is he going to get away? Mash going a little bit too close, gets slowed down, but there's no binding just yet. It'll be a one for nothing.
So managed to pick up at least one kill. Again, deny some farming on Haunter, and it was a big issue for them up in this top lane. Haunter actually won against Rox in his one-on-one. Just see once he's one time here. Denies the jump with the play. Beautiful play by Sheep. Overall, his fresh play has been brilliant so far.
Looking real good, and saw there the calling coming out. Mash just finishing that one off. Leaves him at 1-0-3. Finally picking up the kills as Coast here. Trying to steal away the blue buff. Will steal it as well. It goes over to Golden Glue, so nice little pickup when we heard from Chaox in that little interview. He said, we'd like to time blue, we'd like to deny that from them, doing it this time around.
So the few minutes they had between the games here to actually talk about things, I'm sure he's been telling them, you know what, we need to step it up here, and they're definitely doing a very good job in this game. Also controlling the dragon, they picked up the dragons, got the objective goal, really been putting a lot of pressure here. Backfired a little bit, especially because they gave up some kills over to LoLPro, and maybe went a little bit too aggressive, but also, of course, very nice play by Lord on Nidalee.
Coast probably getting to that point now, approaching 20 minutes, where they're thinking we should be fighting now. We need to push this advantage forward. On the other side, though, LoLPro probably just going to try and tie it away from, do as much damage as they can, land a few spears. As Golden Glue goes, he does force Heaven Time, and he's going to die. It's actually Rux that gets it in the end as he was kicked away. And now Coast may be able to get in onto this inner turret. We'll see if they can hold them off with this next minion wave coming down.
Golden Glue is really using this DFG on LeBlanc to just constantly pick out targets, either kill them or get them so low they have to back so they can now go toward the tower. And one thing we didn't actually talk about in Champ Select is when you look on the side of LoLPro, when you have Nidalee, you don't have much wave clear. Kog'Maw himself, he won't be able to instant clear waves either, so it means Coast, whenever they get a kill, whenever they get someone low, can easily come down to the tower with the minion wave and get a lot of damage or the tower, because LoLPro won't be able to clear it out fast enough. They actually had the same issue in the last game where they also played with Nidalee.
Also, LoLPro here going to go for that top turret. And actually, Rux already recalling from this one and does have home guards as well, so he's going to be powering on back to that inner tower, try and stop that one from going down. Is Mash going to go forward here towards Low? Actually throwing the Cullion out, and he's going to try and dodge away, but Golden Glue coming in, flash from Low over onto the Gonza. Big heal from Nidalee as well. And look at this, they're trying to put down kills here, trying to chase in onto him. Here's Golden Glue, oh, going to take down Haunter. It's another one, he's fourth of the game, and they're going to keep chasing. Oh, no. There is Mash coming in with a lantern. Here is Golden Glue again from the side. He's going to chain up Low. The Hunt coming in, not going to matter here as the plays come around. Hunt stomp goes down. Low's going to die as well. And this is some nice kills coming the way of Coast.
Very, very nice chase from Coast. First, they took the mid tower here. They saw multiple members from World Warp on his top side of the map because Jax was pushing it down. They rotated to the top lane. Coast was like, okay, we're just going to follow you. Managed to get the fight here. First kill or first flash came in actually from Low, and they could just chase them from Coast with, of course, Golden Glue and Sheep being the two members catching on targets or catching targets.
So more items coming in then as well after that one. Void Staff picked up by Golden Glue. Well, that was a couple of minutes ago just before that fight. Got a blasting one now as well. Of course, Mash starting off with the Bloodthirster, we'll be moving up towards the Trinity Force as well. And of course, for Rook, some Fire Cape added in after that Tiamat start. He's got the 5-1-2, having a big game from this top lane.
And Dragon up here in about 25 seconds. Coast already staying around it. They have the pink ward to deny vision from Lulpro, of course. And now just waiting around this area here. Because the auto turrets are gone, they can move into the jungle of Lulpro very easily, very safely, and just put up some wards and wait. And every time, you might be dead.
Oh, yeah. Pretty all easy. We need to say. All yeah. We need to say. DFG going to be thrown out there by Golden Glue. And not good news inside of your own jungle. Actually, Golden Glue stood on top of a ward here, which could be a bit more of a problem for him, but not going to hang around. Dragon, as you mentioned before, comes up. Lantern will bring Mash into the fray, and they're going to finish that one off without any interference from Lulpro. They've got a big gold lead now.
And they got very, very good wards on the map. We just mentioned before here how they can move in the jungle, put on all these wards here, and just spot people for Lulpro moving around. So unless Lulpro stays together as a group, they can always be just caught out of position. And it's what Coast been doing. Issue for Lulpro is they still want to farm. They're not even close to the late game point here. So if they stay as a group, it's going to be even easier for Coast to just pick teammates. And now who's done?
Oh, is he? Yes, he is. Rampage coming out there from Golden Glue. And the surprise is not going to be much of a surprise. Can't keep up with him. And Golden Glue makes it 6-1-4 now. I'm just showing that Lulpro can't really venture into their own jungle anymore.
No, not at all. They can't even push out the lanes because, again, Coast can just move them. Now you got me saying curse. Damn you, Joe.
There's a pink ward taken out. Much to the delight of everyone. Heaven time. Gonna try and get some vision control back. Coast actually sat around a barren area. Possibly just trying to bait them in at this point. They don't have Golden Glue with them, so waiting out for what is a very fed LeBlanc would be rather beneficial, I think. Maybe a bit of an understatement. There's a ward cleared out, or not quite cleared out, two auto attacks coming in. So Lulpro do have vision down there on that front side. And as I say that's taken away as well. Coast again looking for the kills, and Hug Stomp again will be caught out. Not quite the damage to finish off this time around though. And Hug Stomp can think himself lucky for not going down there.
Golden Glue, he did manage to proc the second Q there because he missed his E, but there's nobody from Lulpro to defend this tower here. Now
Heaven Time gonna be hooked into it. We do see the Cullion coming through. Rook's actually got his ultimate running in this one. It's quite a lot of damage that he's taking underneath that tower as well. In him turret, so did take a good bit of damage. Max range finding, there's a spear going in. Golden Glue though gonna take down Morgana. There's a lot of damage from Mash coming as well. Will Lulpro chase this one out? Not sure that they really can, but we can see this Jax getting stronger and stronger now. Got himself that Blade of the Ruined King, Giant's Belt in there as well. Cogmore also doing good amounts of damage. Hudstomp with the Trinity Force, and also got the Cutlass in there as well. So starting to do a bit more damage back to Coast.
And everything started with Coast actually staying around Baron here, setting up some wards, maybe baiting Lulpro to try and face check them. And then just went straight for this mid lane here because Golden Glue went aggressive onto Hoodstomp. Nobody from Lulpro was there to defend it, but teleport in. And once Coast actually decided to go aggressive, they caught them with the first binding. Rox was standing with his ulti. And then the second binding from Low meant the kill. But still, they trade one for one because Golden Glue is so strong. He could just go in and instantly kill Low.
More wards being swept away. Pink ward as well. for LolPro, so they're trying to get some vision back over by the Baron. Starting with those two pink wards, one on the corner, one by the pit itself. Are they going to start things out? They need to be careful still. LeBlanc will be joining back in on the party. 7-1-4 for Golden Glue at this point. Got himself the Rabadon's Death Cap now added into that Void Staff and the Deathfire Grasp from earlier.
Nice little detail from LolPro here when it comes to the wards around Baron. They put one in the Baron pit, and they put one just outside around the corner here. So it means if you put your pink ward inside the Baron pit, you're going to see one of the wards, but you're not going to see the second one. It could actually mean if Coast decides to start a still fairly early Baron, LolPro will know and can come in and try and kill them and maybe turn the whole game around.
Oh, Heaven Time. Gonna be focused there. See though, Lord's Heels, definitely a big player in this one. There is the pink ward down, and there is exactly that ward that you were talking about on the outside. So they've got vision. Golden Glue's gonna go on to Heaven Time. It's dead. Not gonna get away
from
that
smite.
One. And that is your smite gone. That makes his Baron now a lot safer. Four Coast. Rook's gonna get that ultimate up and running as they go in, trying to get on towards Hunts, a big spear on towards Sheep, but they've not got the follow-up damage for it. Mash coming through, he takes a spear as well, and they've managed to keep Coast away from the Baron.
Very, very hard. Even though your jungler is dead, you can still poke with Nidalee here, you can poke with everything you have, and it's very hard for Coast to actually take the Baron this early on without taking some damage. So as long as they have some wards in there, I can at least see them started, they can always move in, poke from the side of LolPro and force Coast away, even though they had to give up the jungler's life.
No DFG there for Golden Glue, meant no kill onto Lod. Swanter is gonna wait. Is he gonna dive over for Mash? No, he's not. Just waiting for him to get away so he can get a bit more farm. 185 CS he's currently sat on. Got all the workings of that Randuin's. That'll be finished off probably on his next journey home from this.
Both top laners here, I mean, looking at last game, it was Rocks on Jax, he had issues early on, he was shut down, he had to build Blade, Phage, and then go Tank, because he couldn't go straight for Trinity Force, he would be too squishy in these team fights. This time around, Taunts are now on Jax, being behind, he has to do the exact same thing, delaying his Trinity Force, building some tankiness, it's very, very smart, so he can actually be joining in for these fights, he won't just jump in and die instantly. I mean, Golden Blue would just pop him. Should get some magic resist next, other than just his boots, otherwise, yeah, Golden Blue can seem as a very easy target.
Pretty much the same story for everyone, though, I think is the real problem here for LolPro. We see them again setting up a bit of a trap, and I think realizing they're not actually going to get that one as Mash waits for Dragon. Still got 30 seconds, though, until that actually comes into play, so not readily available for them. Also, we should take a look at the overall picture. We're almost 30 minutes into this game and a very solid lead. Four codes, but will it be enough of a lead as this game goes later?
Only time will tell. I mean, they're focused on trying to get the Baron here instead of actually using the very, very strong LeBlanc to spread out in multiple lanes and just push multiple lanes down. And if LolPro tries to do anything against any of the split pushes, Golden will just move out, one shot target. Instead, they've been focusing around Baron for the last few minutes and it's actually buying time for LolPro, and they're doing the exact same thing once again with the wards, so they know they have one inside and one outside. We've required two pink wards now from Coast to clip or of course the sweeping lens. However, because Coast is so focused on this Baron here, they're giving time to LolPro to farm, and they have been using it. I mean, look, Hoodstorm just completed his Trinity or played his Drone King, so while he's slowly building up, he's at least building up here. We do actually see Coast now just abandoning the Baron and deciding to do the split push, so I like this move from them.
Oh, Hoodstomp might be in a little bit of trouble. There's a ward over right on top of Golden Glue, but this turret now needs to be dealt with. It's Heaven Time going to be focused on taking a lot of damage as the Culling comes through. They need to hit the tower. They will finish that one off. Not going to be able to push through further, though, on towards the inhibitor. More damage coming out as the binding flashes by the rest of the Coast team. And there is a jump in again from Golden Glue, using the double with his ultimate, but wasn't able to pick up another kill. But they've got that inhibitor turret down now.
That's a very big deal for Coast. It means if Golden Glue picks up a target by himself, he can move down towards the inhibitor and force LolPro to send people back to defend the mid lane, and then opens up simply for the two side lanes where the rest of Coast can then just push in, pick up a tower, open some more inhibitors for them.
Well, not much to say about that one. That's without the Deathfire Grasp as well.
And this is why you don't care about Baron, because you're so strong. I mean, just split out on the map, get kills left and right. I mean, Golden Glue have been doing it pretty much the entire game. Now the rest of the team can just go down, punish LolPro, take a tower, take an inhibitor, or go four members up to Baron now, and just leave Golden Glow to jump around by himself.
Oh, actually jumping away from this one, did catch the spear from Lod. Well, decide to back away. Gonna be some more ward clearing going out from Coast side there, up by Baron. Just trying his best to get things farming. He got himself a pickaxe now added in. See whether he goes up towards that last whisper next. And a big spear onto Santorin as well, who still yet to die across both of these games.
Bit of a passive role for Santorin. I mean, he's not exactly a jungler, at least not in these games, to just jump in your face, setting up kills all the time, or being the guy to tank for everyone else. I mean, he's playing these elites very passive, and he's just looking to land cocoons, and once he lands one, he goes in, does some damage, backs away here. And it's been working for him. I mean, okay, this game's only been part of a few kills, but Lod, you're dead.
Oh, that's a lot of damage, actually getting a big heal off there as well, but the Baron was already started here by Coast. They've got Vision, that ward will be timing out soon. There comes the TP, they've actually brought themselves away. Is Heaventide going to go down? They do get one back though with Jax. Holter, however, is all alone as he pops at Randuin. Is he going to be able to back away? Yes, he will. We'll leap strike to the rest of his team. That leaves them in a one for one, but the jungler down for LoLPro here.
Once again, they trade one for one. The jungler goes down, but LoLPro, they manage to stop the Baron again. They buy more time where they can farm up here. Coast, they keep going for this Baron here, and LoLPro, because they keep putting a ward just outside the Baron pit, they have Vision. This time around though, we did see a Hunter teleport to the ward, so Sheep should know. Next time he puts down the pink, he needs to sweep his lens as well, to make sure there isn't a ward just around the corner.
Check the inside and the outside of that pit, and something that LoLPro have done really well of so far, making sure that they keep Vision. However, Coast decide to place that pink ward there, and we can see again they're already up on the Baron pit, getting more Vision away from Coast side of things. Coast themselves going a little bit more back into farming mode. You see Rooks going down bottom. TP available to him, and knowing that Hunter used his TP for that last Baron actually has the advantage there.
It could really open up if Coast wants to go split pushing once again. He's in the bottom lane now. Rest of the members just go down towards the mid lane. Golden Glow look for a target. If Hunter joins Rocks in his bottom lane, he won't be able to join for a team fight or the Baron if Coast then rotates after picking a kill to the Baron. Rocks joins in. Five members, easy Baron for Coast here. They're just pushing up. Just keep an eye on Golden Glow. I mean, he's the guy who's going to look for the kill.
Right, and dive in there onto one of them. And could be anyone as well with that Deathfire grass. Certainly got the ability to pop every single man on the map there as the binding comes through, doesn't quite land. Golden Glow continuing to keep that Vision War on the side of Coast. That's really not exactly super healthy. They need to be a little bit careful. They managed to catch out Hotstomp though. They're going to focus straight in. He will actually flash away from it, and they turn around the damage onto Santorin. He takes the lantern away to safety. Rooks did walk up from that bottom lane as well. They've got minions coming in now, so LoLPro going to be faced with a choice.
And they force the flash from Hotstomp here. Also, the barrier is on cooldown. Golden Glow, it's a very easy target for him if he gets close to him.
Oh. Going very low, but needing the final hit. Oh. There we go. Oh, spear comes through, but the Spiderlings saving Santorin's life. Still yet to die throughout this game. And they're going to back away now on towards the Baron area. Still a few wards down there from LoLPro, so they're not going to be completely blind.
The will of Superman is pushing down the mid lane now. Teleport from Hunter is still not up yet. Should be up though for when it actually becomes relevant, and he can then stay in this bottom lane or the mid lane to clear the waves, while the rest of LoLPro can try and move a more safe way through their own blue buff towards this Dragon or Baron pit here. For now, they're actually just pushing up this mid lane because Coast took all the way up to the blue buff and all the way up to the top lane, so they're not even in position to try and defend.
Nowhere near in position to defend this one.
No minions though, so.
Yeah. One single is not going to really help them out there, and they back away. Not really getting too much damage. I think one or maybe two auto attacks it was that came in there in the end. We've also seen a couple more items coming out. Locket of the Iron Solari finished for Elise. We've got Quicksilver Sash as well for Mash. So maybe feeling a little bit more confident to avoid that CC. And obviously they do have the Mikhail's Crucible as well with a support. So kind of double get you out of jail cards there for Coast.
Same wards this time around though. Actually not spotted yet, but now Coast are pinging on the ward placement, so they know this time around where the wards are going to be around this Baron, so they can now clear them fully and therefore take the Baron. or start the Baron without any vision. You actually see Pingo just right on the spot, making sure we can see everything now.
Are they going to kick it off? They've just taken themselves the dragon. And they are in a commanding lead. If you look at the gold as well, really, really big lead for Coast. And again, they're going to back away on towards the Baron area.
So one ward here is spotting them, at least going towards the Baron. So they know it started, can now move up here. No teleport on Haunter yet though, not sure why he was staying in bottom.
I was going to say, he's miles away from that one. Cogmore's not anywhere near it really either, and they're going to hook him. Oh, that's an easy kill for them. That's probably going to cost them this Baron in the end. And we can see already that they've started to back away from this one of LoLPro. So a couple of spears coming through from Nidalee, but a 5v4 fight is not what they want. And it's Coast that take the first Baron of the game.
So finally they managed to clear all the wards around it, and also because Haunter was in this bottom lane without teleport. I said earlier, teleport should be ready before it became relevant. I was wrong, it was actually not ready yet, and he was in this bottom lane farming, so Coast with a very quick decision, straight for the Baron, and just managed to pick up a kill as well. Now they can push down towards the second inhibitor.
Which you always have to wonder, your teleport's not, why are you in the bottom lane? When Coast have obviously been showing attention over towards that Baron, as we are going to see Golden Glue going in again. It's going to force them to back off it, and that gives them the inhibitor and the inhibitor now finished off. But Stomp actually doing good amounts of damage from the side. We see Haunter going to get his Counter-Strike going. Will dive in there, but not really the damage to finish off. There's a Repel. He's going to come right back down on top of him. Takes the Lantern though, and Mash doing great damage back. Heaventide has to flash away. Haunter in the middle of them. Surely he will be finished off. Mash gets one onto Heaventide. Santorin going to go low,
but
still
minion.
Not finished off. Super Minions are in the base, are on the Nexus turrets already. LoLPro have to look at this one. I don't think they can do it. They've got three men down. Nexus turret's going to be finished off. Lord and Huntstop trying to hold on to it. Sheep will fall there. Will they go around the backside there? Golden Glue getting another one. Are they going to go for Lord? Or will they focus down the turret and the Nexus? It's Golden Glue that gets the double in the end. Nexus goes down and Coast going to pick up the 2-0 victory.
So it didn't take 20 minutes like Garrick said. However, they picked a very strong early mid-game comp here and they really used it well. They got far ahead. Golden Glue just kept picking up targets left and right here. Rox was very, very strong on Renekton as well and just managed to get the lead here. Well, this used some time around this Baron here because there constantly was a ward on them to see they actually started, so they took a lot of poke from it. It bought some time for LoLPro, but not enough here, and Cursed or Coast was simply too strong.
And really incredible play from them. We saw in that last game holding on for so, so long. LoLPro pushing down on the inhibitors, managed to hold it out, win a fight, get Baron, win the game. In this one, went for that more early game based composition, and Golden Glue, have to take your hat off to him. 12-1-6, he finishes there by the end, and not really anyone was safe from him.
It was just a perfect setup for him because they got all these out of turrets down so early. So he just went into the jungle with his support, with the rest of his team, warded everything, and then he just stood there and he just waited. Often it was Heaventide, poor guy, moving in, face checking him, and he just died again and again. There's nothing he could do because his entire jungle was warded up. And we talked about how LoLPro, they couldn't just group up early because they needed time to ramp up. Jax, of course, needs a lot of time here. Hoostop needed to farm even more to get into his late game point as well. So they couldn't group up early and start fighting. They had to just stay and farm, and it was so risky for them. And therefore, Golden Glue could just take kills left and right.
And Haunter just couldn't get going in that one. Completely shut down out of the game. We actually saw him in game number one. Honestly, was pretty fantastic. Had a really strong game. Went for the Jax this time around, obviously fitting more into what LoLPro were going for here with a comp. But
he swapped plays with Rox, pretty much.
Pretty much. I
mean, shut down early, had to go for some tankiness, couldn't become the split-pushing monster, had to just try and farm up, and it was just too late. Rox instead, he got to the 62-minute point at like 6 items and was a monster on Jax in the end, not in the start or mid of the game.
And how do you hold off a team like that where you've got the LeBlanc who's picking you off constantly inside your own jungle? There were 2, 3, 4 kills maybe where people were just walking through round about the red buff mostly. I mean, how do you stop a LeBlanc like that?
Well, the thing is, once you hit this point, there's pretty much nothing you can do other than sit in your own base and just try and hold them off, or hold them off Baron as long as possible. Because once LeBlanc gets going, and they have this very strong early comp, and you lose all your auto turrets, so you lose all the vision control on the map. It's just very hard to do anything, so you need to make sure you don't give LeBlanc the kills early on. I know it's easy to say here, I mean, but that's basically the thing. I mean, you can't fall this far behind against the LeBlanc and then open up the map like they did. They tried to just deny around the Baron here. Wasn't enough.
Well, fantastic 2-0 win there for Coast. We're going to send it over to Shox, who's on the stage with the victorious Golden Glue and Mash from Team Coast. Take it away, Shox.
Thank you very much, Joe. And indeed, joined here by Golden Glue and Mash. Rightful applause after that victory for you guys. Mash, take me through game one, because it seemed like you guys took a little time to get started in the game.
At the beginning, we didn't get any blues for our Ziggs, so the game became very troublesome. But I said to our team, like, we can still win, and just got to keep going through it all the time. And we just stuck it all the way.
You absolutely did. And Golden Glue, you didn't have the best time in that game one in the mid lane versus Nidalee.
No, I did not. I got denied blue buff multiple times, and I basically just got shoved on over and over and just like stayed in the base and just pressed Q. It was pretty boring.
But you guys did make it, and especially you had a great showing on LeBlanc in game two. Tell us a little bit about how you mediated going into game two and, well, putting through that early game aggression.
Well, we knew their spirits were going to be crushed from game one because they nearly took our base and they lost. So we picked an early game comp just to dominate them in the early game, and it worked out.
Well, Chaox said in the interview, well, they didn't listen to me. Normally, we play fast, and then we push through. Did you listen to the almighty Chaox then, or did you just come up with it yourself?
I always try to take it, like, his opinion, and I try to mix it with our team's opinions. So that's how we do our picks and bans. Sometimes it doesn't feel right, but, you know, it's always good to listen to everybody's opinions. But, yeah, always try to listen to Chaox.
Take the best of both worlds. Now, final question, of course. This is a next step into getting into the LCS for your team. How big do you think your chances are? If you look at the challenger scene right now, how good are you?
I think we have the best chance out of any challenger team to make it into the LCS. And I think if we just keep practicing and playing how we are, we will get into the LCS.
Mash, how big is the hunger to get back in there?
I don't know. It's still a big step because we're still a new team. We only played a total of 3 days with Santorin. So I think we have a lot to work on, but I think we definitely have the chance.
Absolutely. Great showing from you guys. Congratulations once again.
Thank you.
And as for us, we're going to take a closer look at that last game together at the analyst desk with D-Man and Trevor.
Thank you very much, Shox. And I think we just saw Golden Glue talk about pretty much what we wanted to start off with, and that was the pick and ban phase. And, you know, we were talking about it. LoLPro basically went all late game. And as we just saw Golden Glue say, we went early game, and basically it worked out.
Yeah, it really did. When you look at LoLPro's composition, they really had a collection of champions that needed a lot of time to scale. Nidalee needs items. It's a mid-game power spike. Jax, late game. Kog'Maw, late game. But there was not enough protection. Lee Sin's got one kickback. Morgana can maybe stun some people. And whenever you've got these late scaling champions, you need peel, you need protection, like a Thresh, like a Zarya, even like a Nami, just to disengage and buy time for your team to actually get ahead. All of the champions on the side of Coast, early game, lots of damage, and they could dash and dive. Renekton, Elise, LeBlanc, they could move all over the map, and they did.
And speaking about that damage, of course, we harped on about Golden Glue, how he didn't really have any impact in the start of the game in game one. Absolutely had impact in this game, played a fantastic LeBlanc, probably the best we've seen Golden Glue play.
Yeah, that is actually, in my mind, the strongest performance you've seen him play, and that's taking into account his games in the LCS. One of the highlights we want to pull up onto your screen right now is just how Coast were forcing objectives very early on. Their composition needed to get objectives, needed to get ahead, and needed to stay ahead. Keep your eyes on how quickly Hoodstomp is going to get blown up in a moment or two as we roll this clip out. You can see that Golden Glue is already roaming. He's coming in from the sideline, and he's gonna jump in, get a lot of damage down. The problem that Coast had is they overcommitted several times for these objectives. And even though they're trading somewhat evenly, one for one, one for two in certain fights, their team comp had to make those plays. Their team comp had to get the towers and had to push. If they had been maybe a little more aware of the response from opponents, they could have got out cleaner. But nevertheless, they got the tower, they got the kills, and they kept doing that for the rest of the game.
And that was also one of the problems LoLPro had, is they overcommitted a few too many times, which is where they got caught out, really.
Yeah, it is. And this is actually the second replay that we're going to pull up onto your screen. LoLPro were under pressure. They needed to make plays, or they felt like they needed to pull themselves back in the game. If you roll this clip out, what you're really going to see is just how little protection LoLPro has for their carries. LoL gets forced away. You'll notice that Lodge is on the full retreat. Hoodstomp in a moment or two, he's on retreat, but there's nothing to protect them. There's nothing to stop the members of Coast just chasing them down. And Coast are gonna run literally halfway across the map and continue putting pressure. Lodge's gonna get chased around from the side. Hoodstomp gets blown up. And this is the problem that LoLPro had in their team comp. No protection for the carries, and of course, They fell behind early, which allowed Coast to make these plays happen.
And just so much chase for Coast. So Coast are victorious. Another 2-0 for the Challenger Series. What do we see going forward? Are they going to continue to go through? Obviously, they're going to be trying to challenge the LCS teams eventually in the next split.
Something that we kept talking about during this series was just how the individual ability was actually very high. Mm. There were some really good moments from a lot of players involved. Sheep got his strongest champion in Thresh and landed some phenomenal hooks. There is still some work that can be done if these teams want to challenge the LCS squads, but it's definitely very exciting. First Challenger Series of summer locked in, and we'll see who's going to go to the playoffs later in the year.
Yeah, some definite skill play on show there. That, of course, wraps up the North American Challenger Finals. Congratulations again to Team Coast for taking the series in two wins. And a special thank you to our friends at Coca-Cola, of course, as well, for sponsoring that event. Right now, though, we have to take a very short break, but when we return, the European LCS will kick off its second day of games here in London, as Rocket will be taking on Gambit Gaming right after this.
Dope. I mean, this is just for fun, dude. You made it to the finals, you made it to London, like, do your best, like, whatever. It is what it is, man.
That will actually end them in a 1-for-1. It's Lord as well that gets the kill, so both the mid laners getting killed.
Oh my god!
The hook coming in, not gonna matter here as the plays come round. Hook stuff goes down, Lowe's gonna die as well. And Mash doing great damage back every time, has to flash away. Hunter in the middle of them, surely he will be finished off. Mash gets one onto Heaven Time. Santorin gonna go low.